Good morning and welcome to New Hanover County Schools The Morning Show. I'm Sierra Dummermuth.
And I'm Jimmy Barnes. This is the week of March 13th through the 19th.
This week our show is all about one of America's favorite foods, pizza. We have a special pizza lesson and a fun pizza game to close the show.
Along with our pizza fun, today's show is also packed with many entertaining features.
We introduce a brand new segment called Cooking with Caitlin. Our chef host will show us how to make a quick, easy, and delicious snack.
And in Snapchats, we highlight a few of the wonderful things that we have been doing, that have been going on in our school system this past month.
But first, let's check in with our news anchor, Bridget Donovan, for a look at this morning's Zero School News headlines. Good morning, Bridget.
Good morning, Sierra and Jimmy, and welcome everyone to Your School News here on The Morning Show. Topping the headlines this week, All County Honors Art Clinics launched, New Hanover High School holds CTE Elective Showcase, and School District holds a Magnet and Year-Round School Options Fair. I will have all these stories and more coming up later in the show.
Thanks, Bridget.
Okay, get ready to laugh because it's time for the joke of the week.
Students in Ms. Clayton's Honors Drama class at Ashley High School have performed these jokes in the morning show.
Now you can start each day off with a dose of humor.
Here's our joke of the week.
So two men are out and about walking their dogs when they pass by a restaurant. One man suggests that they go in and get something to eat, but the other man says, "We can't. See the sign? No pets allowed." And the other man says, "Oh, that sign. Don't worry about it." So the man puts some sunglasses on and walks to the door. Once he's inside, a hostess stops him and says, "Sorry, no pets allowed." And the man says to her, "Can't you see? I'm blind. This is my seeing eye dog." And the hostess says, confused, "But it's a Doberman Pinscher. Since when are Doberman Pinschers seeing eye dogs?" And the man says, "Don't you know? These are the latest kinds of seeing eye dogs. They do a very good job." So the second man, seeing what he did, tries to walk in with his chihuahua. Before he can say anything, the hostess says, "Now, don't tell me that a chihuahua is the latest type of seeing eye dog." Thinking quickly, the man angrily replies, "You're telling me they gave me a chihuahua?"
Another awesome joke of the week. Thank you, Lainey. Thank you, Ashley Honors Drama.
And now it's time for a staple here on The Morning Show, This Week in History. Our Grandmasters of Historical Knowledge has all the headlines from the past times in This Week in History, brought to you by Kidsville News.
Welcome to This Week in History. I'm your historical host, Rocco Solano, covering all the colorful and amazing events that have left their mark on history's timeline. This is the week of March 13th through March 19th. March 13th, 1868. For the first time in U.S. history, the impeachment trial of an American president gets underway in the U.S. Senate. President Andrew Johnson stood accused of having violated the controversial Truth of Office Act. He was eventually acquitted. March 14th, 1879. Albert Einstein is born in Germany. Einstein's theory of special and general relativity drastically altered man's views of the universe. His work in particle and energy theory helped make possible quantum mechanics and ultimately the atomic bomb. March 15th, 44 BC. Julius Caesar, the dictator of the Roman Empire, is murdered by his own senators at a meeting. A conspiracy against Caesar encompasses as many as 60 noblemen, including Caesar's own protege, Marcus Brutus. March 16th, 1802. The United States Military Academy, the first military school in the United States, is founded by Congress for the purpose of educating and training young men in the theory and practice of military science. March 17th, 1901. Paintings by the late Dutch painter Vincent van Gogh are shown at a gallery in Paris. 71 paintings, which capture their subjects in bold brushstrokes and impressive colors, caused a sensation across the art world. Finally, your weekend history tidbits. March 18th, 1925. The worst tornado in U.S. history passes through eastern Missouri, southern Illinois, and southern Indiana. It killed 695, injured over 13,000, and caused $17 million in property damage. March 19th, 1931. In an attempt to lift the state out of the hard times of the Great Depression, the Nevada State Legislature votes to legalize gambling. Today, state gambling taxes account for the lion's share of Nevada's overall tax revenues. That's This Week in History, your ultimate sources for those key moments in time. I'm Rocco Salerno. Thanks for stopping by.
This Week in History is brought to you by Kidsville News, a fun and effective learning resource for children, teachers, and parents. Kidsville News is always free. Copies are delivered every month to every elementary school in the New Hanover County school system.
And join us again next time for another journey through time as we explore the fun, fascinating, entertaining, and educational facts that make up This Week in History.
We have plenty more of the morning show ahead, including Science Nation and this week's lunch menu.
Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
For more simple ways to fight the flu, visit www.flu.gov.
This is the hand that sows the seed, that grows the forest, that drinks from the stream, that hugs the mountain, that gives shape to the wind, that carries the kite, that is flown by the child, that is loved by the woman, that toils at the job, that gives to Earthshare, that supports the hand, that sows the seed.
All life is woven together. How can we choose which environmental cause to support? Earthshare, the workplace giving program, makes it simple by bringing the leading environmental groups together under one umbrella. Support Earthshare, and you support them all, including the hands that sow the seeds and protect the forests and the streams and the children. To learn more, please visit our website.
Welcome back to The Morning Show. I'm Sierra Dimmermuth.
And I'm Jimmy Barnes.
It's one of America's favorite foods, the go-to meal at parties, and the perfect meal for the family when you don't feel like cooking. It's pizza, and we all know it and love it.
However, how much about pizza do you actually know? To fill you in on a bite of this delicious food history and share all the fun pizza facts, we have a special segment for you this morning.
So sit back and get ready to learn all about pizza.
Pizza is a truly international food with over 5 billion sold worldwide each year. Nowadays, people of all classes and social status eat pizza. However, when pizza originated in 997 AD, it was strictly a peasant's food. It wasn't until the late 18th century, when the royalty of the time began eating pizza, that its popularity began to rise. As its popularity among the wealthy grew, street vendors began to open up storefronts and pizzerias were here to stay. Pizza didn't start out looking like we know it today. Pizza existed for over 500 years before tomatoes were added to it, and it was actually the first Italian food to use tomatoes. For centuries, tomatoes were thought to be poisonous, but during a trying time, the citizens of Naples had run out of other foods and were forced to eat them. When they realized the delicious food was not toxic, they began to use tomato sauce on everything, and the modern pizza was born. These days, along with the crust, tomato sauce, and cheese, there are dozens of toppings sold regularly, and nearly every food has been tried as a topping at least once. Pizza types can now be differentiated by the size of the crust, the amount of toppings, and the way it is cooked, and the types of toppings on the pizza. One of the biggest differences in pizzas in America is between the Chicago deep dish style and the New York thin crust. The Chicago deep dish pizza was designed to have more food on the plate and to be eaten as a meal. The New York style, on the other hand, was designed to be a portable snack. In America, New York style thin crust is preferred, with 61% of the people preferring it over the Chicago deep dish. Along with all the different types of toppings and crust, many different cheeses are used on pizza. Mozzarella is the most common, found on 60% of pizzas, and there's a reason for it. Mozzarella has the best baking property of the cheeses, having high moisture and low quantities of free oil. Here are a few fun pizza tidbits from around the world. In Italy, they take their pizza serious. So serious, in fact, that there's a bill before Parliament to ensure pizza maintains a certain quality, making it illegal to call an improperly prepared pizza a traditional Italian pizza. The largest pizza ever made was in South Africa. The pizza measured 37.4 meters in diameter and weighed almost 27,000 pounds. It had 1,100 pounds of flour, 1,750 pounds of cheese, and 2,000 pounds of tomatoes. Every year, the International Pizza Expo is held in Las Vegas. At the show, pizza connoisseurs from all over the world meet to share their trade secrets and see the newest secrets in the world of pizza. The expo is closed to the public, so only pizza professionals can see the secrets. There's the fun facts and brief history of pizza, from a peasant's food using a poisonous plant to one of the most eaten foods in the world. Pizza is a defining food of our planet.
We hope you enjoyed our spectacular pizza special.
It's time now for our first block of news. Let's send it over to Bridget Donovan, who has several great stories to report. Good morning, Bridget.
Good morning, and welcome to Your School News on the Morning Show. I'm Bridget Donovan. Our top story this week: New Hanover County Schools held its first annual All-County Honors Art Clinics. This event was not only the first in the county, but the first in the country. With a complete report on this event is YSN reporter Ivan Santiago.
New Hanover County Schools launched its first All-County Honors Art Clinic for students in elementary, middle, and high school. The goal of the event was to celebrate visual arts in the same way that chorus and band are celebrated. Art teachers were asked to bring their best student in their upper level classes to attend the event.
I think it's the only all-county art show maybe in the country. We run it just like band or choir. The teachers pick a couple of their star students. They bring them here. We have professors who are teaching these students the different art mediums of printmaking. Our high school level is learning collage from one of our local artists. We don't think it's been done anywhere else, so it's very unique right now.
The event was divided between two locations. Elementary school students explored the art of printmaking at UNCW. Through hands-on activities, students discovered that printmaking normally covers only the process of creating prints that have an element of originality, rather than just being a photographic reproduction of a painting. Except in the case of monotyping, the process is capable of producing multiples of the same piece, which is called a print.
Today we have been printmaking. We've been putting the ink, we've been making negative images. It's been really fun.
Usually everyone does somewhat of the same thing, and here you can kind of express yourself in different ways.
Because we don't normally use all these different tools, and we normally just like paint or like color in art class and learn different techniques, where this is where you're doing all different kinds of tools and materials.
The entire event was beyond belief, not only for the students, but the teachers as well.
I think it's a fantastic program. I'm super excited. Our children are very, very excited. We're still learning how it all works as we go along, but it is a fantastic idea, and I think it's going to give us a lot of exposure in the community, and it's going to give our kids something that they've never had before.
Middle and high school students met with local collage artist Catherine Wolf Webb, who taught the class the importance of simplicity and efficiency. On the first day of the event, Catherine asked the class to cut out 5 shapes and create a composition that they felt proud of. Next, they were given a black sheet of paper and asked to make the composition stronger with it. Finally, they were asked to choose a colored paper and finalize the composition.
To go make art all day long, so that's a very rare opportunity. I don't think we've ever done anything like this before, so.
The All-County Art Clinics was capped off with a presentation of creations in a special showing in the lobby of UNCW's Cultural Art Building. It was a chance for parents and the community at large to see firsthand the creations of the diverse group of young artists. After the event, both teachers and students agreed that it was a fun and valuable experience that they can learn from to improve their art skills. Reporting from Your School News, this is Ivan Santiago.
Sunset Park Elementary hosted its 6th African American Read-In. Over 1 million readers of all ethnic groups from 49 states, the West Indies, and African countries took part in similar events last month. The Read-In is an effective way to promote diversity in children's literature, instill in young people the importance of reading, and highlight a variety of African American authors. Several community guest readers visited Sunset Park Elementary to share their love of reading with the students. Kindergarten students even presented a Black History performance. In the individual classrooms, guest readers read their selections, discussed and interacted with students, leaving a positive, lasting impression on both the children and adults involved. New Hanover High School held its annual CTE elective showcase. This event is designed to give rising ninth graders a chance to review and understanding the wide number of electives offered at New Hanover High School. With a complete report on this event is YSN reporter Caden Kay.
New Hanover High School recently held their annual elective showcase for rising ninth graders. This electrifying event was held to help students and parents make informed and smart choices for course registration. To welcome the future ninth graders were ROTC students, Drama Club, and the Graphics Art Club. Taking part in this event was a great opportunity for future high schoolers to get an idea of what to look forward to in coming years at New Hanover High School.
I liked the elective showcase because it literally demonstrated all of the electives and what you can do in them.
I thought it was very useful because before coming to this, I didn't really know what the electives were and also like what happened in the electives. And also I learned that these electives are important as the core classes.
The backbone of the elective showcase were the career and technical education courses known as CTE. CTE gives high school students the chance to get a head start on preparing for college and careers by incorporating academic, creative, and technical skills. Through these courses, students acquire deep academic skills to use in the future.
Well, in personal finance, it's pretty much talking about how we manage and how to get prepared for our future. And we pretty much talk about managing money and the well-being of, pretty much talk about debit and credit cards and how much trouble you can get in if you really don't be safe with it.
Drafting is engineering, basically. We start off with a level one class, which deals with architecture and building basic parts. At the end of drafting one, you do get AutoCAD certified, which is the program we use. And AutoCAD certifications really get looked at for colleges.
Booths were set up and gave students a look into offerings like business information and technology, health occupations, and trade industrial education. The philosophy behind the showcase was to have the freshmen begin looking into future plans. CTE courses are a very good idea in thinking for the future. Thinking for the future is what this event gave the freshmen from Williston, Noble, Virgil Prep, Holly Shelter, and Myrtle Grove the ability to plan ahead with work and ponder on their field of study. New Hanover High School was very accommodating and informative to the future students, and some even took tours of the school campus. The event left participants with a lot to think ahead about as they plan for their high school years. Reporting for Your School News, this is Caden Kay.
For all the latest on New Hanover County Schools, join us weekdays at 5:30 p.m. here on Time Warner Cable Channel 5 and Charter Cable 191 for Your School News, a complete half hour of all the latest news and information from New Hanover County Schools. Now back to our hosts.
Thanks, Bridget. We continue our show with Science Nation from the National Science Foundation. This feature takes a dynamic, entertaining look at the research and the researchers that will change our lives.
From the latest inventions to studies that could change the way we perceive the world, each episode is packed with fascinating information.
These tiny creatures are Arctic surf clams. They're getting packed up for a trip to the shore. With some help, they're about to take up residence in an intertidal mudflat on the Maine coast. Down east, as they say around here.
What we're doing is looking to see whether or not we can diversify the U.S. product for shellfish, and at the same time try to increase the number of jobs that people would have around this particular species.
Brian Beal is a marine ecologist with the University of Maine at Machias. With support from the National Science Foundation, he and a team based at the Downeast Institute are putting their aquaculture innovation skills to work. They're focused on two types of shellfish with the potential to bring more jobs and dollars to the area, blue mussels and Arctic surf clams.
So these offspring here are about 2 years old. And when you go into Canada, this particular species, this Arctic surf clam, is a $50 million industry there, and it's a $0 industry here. When it's cooked, it has a very, very distinct color, very, very, very appealing, and its taste is very nice.
But it's no small task to develop a viable new commercial species from the ground up. They've worked out a lot of the kinks, like showing the clams can survive, even thrive, when farmed here, and coaxing them to spawn in the hatchery so they can build up stock. But there is a problem. The green crab is an invasive species that has taken this part of the Maine coast by storm in recent decades and has a particular taste for the Arctic surf clam.
We're not sure why, but it's either one of two things. They're either easier to open or they're better for the animal, and so it gets more energy from them.
Beal says the obvious solution is to keep the clams in nurseries like these until they're big enough that the crabs can't break them open. But that could take over a year and make the whole effort cost prohibitive.
If we can't do the next step, the grow out to commercial sizes in the field at any reasonable survival rate, well then, you know.
They've tried caging the clams inside PVC pipes closed off with mesh. The crabs made short work of those. But they're hot at work on a new design. On the other hand, blue mussels aren't new to Maine. They've been a part of the seafood industry here for years.
That particular species is one where people are culturing it by collecting the small juveniles on ropes that they suspend from docks in the water column.
Beal's team wants to make mussel aquaculture more of a turnkey operation. They've figured out their spawning behaviors at the hatchery, determined what kinds of algae work best for their diet, and even tested different kinds of rope to see which the mussels attach to best. They've developed a novel bag system to keep them contained as they grow.
The incorporation of the bag to simply catch those that fall off or jump off would be certainly useful to ensure that none of these mussels are going to go onto the bottom.
Beal sees a day when farmers would buy ropes already seeded with juveniles, bagged up and ready to go in the water. It's the kind of innovation that drives him. He grew up here, working on the water, and wants to find ways to give back to the community.
I feel very lucky to be able to do these projects and do this research that not only scratch my scientific curiosity, but also can help and have helped clammers and lobster fishermen and worm diggers and scallopers and people that make their living off of the ocean.
It seems even in the fishing industry, you reap what you sow. For Science Nation, I'm Miles O'Brien.
That was interesting. Hopefully, if their efforts are successful with growing clam and oysters, that we can use some of their methods here in North Carolina.
That would be great. I know all across the coastline, people are looking for ways to increase and improve commercial fishing and clamming, as well as maintaining a balance.
Yes, and every science breakthrough in that area is a big help.
All right, it's time for a quick break. Stay tuned, we'll be right back.
There are so many fun things we all can do to be healthier, no matter who you are or where you are. So let's move.
And we're underway.
Let's stretch in the grass.
And we're ready to go.
Let's play tag.
What a play.
Let's jump up and down.
What a way to finish it.
And most of all, let's eat better so that we have the energy we need to play an hour a day every day.
Anyone can play. Just go to letsmove.gov to learn more.
You know what, guys? There's a lot of tree branches and dry brush over here. We should probably move the bonfire over there.
I'm guessing Smokey liked that idea.
Welcome back to The Morning Show. It's time now to introduce our newest segment to The Morning Show, Cooking with Caitlin. In each episode, our host, Caitlin Ledman, will show us the ingredients and how to put them together to make an easy, nutritious, and delicious snack. Follow her advice and lead your taste buds to amazing flavors. Here's Cooking with Caitlin.
Hello everybody and welcome to Cooking with Caitlin. My name is Caitlin Ledman and today we are making guacamole. First, before you start, make sure your hands are washed and if you have long hair, your hair is up. We are going to make guacamole with avocados and they have vitamins such as E, C, and K and B2 and they are also a fruit. We are also using ingredients such as tomatoes, red onion, salt, garlic, and jalapenos. So let's scoop out the pit on our avocado. This one's stubborn. And let's put the rest of it in the bowl. Same with this half. Next, we'll add our tomatoes. Red onion. Jalapenos. Garlic. And a little bit of salt. So next, let's mix all of our stuff together. It doesn't matter if you like chunky or smooth guacamole. You can use a fork to get it all together. Just press down, but I prefer chunky. And because I like to have all the chunks together. Next, we'll put it in our bowl. And then we are going to put in a little bit of lime juice. Combine that in. And put it into our bowl. Got a little bit left over. I like red pepper, so I'm gonna try it with a little bit of red pepper. It's pretty good. Thank you for watching Cooking with Caitlin. I hope you enjoy.
Thank you, Caitlin. That looked like a delicious yet healthy treat.
Yes, yeah, something we can all try at home, either as a small snack or to put out for when friends come over.
We look forward to more episodes and seeing what else Caitlin will whip up.
All right, it's time now for this week's lunch menu. This is the menu for Monday, March 13th through Monday, March 20th.
On Monday, March 13th, a chicken parmesan sandwich, a beef taco with Spanish rice, or a cheeseburger will be headlining your school lunch menu. The supporting cast includes wonderful barbecue pinto beans and a spectacular frozen fruit cup.
Then on Tuesday, March 14th, make haste to the lunch line for a pork chop sandwich, a grand grilled cheese sandwich, or soothing stuffed crust pizza. And on your way to the table, be sure to pick up some exquisite vegetable sticks, tempting tater tots, and appeasing applesauce.
On Wednesday, March 15th, feast like royalty on chicken fried rice with an egg roll, the cheesiest cheesy breadsticks, or yummy pork barbecue served with hush puppies and slaw. Become truly magnificent by adding the sides of pasta salad, glorious glazed carrots, and mandarin oranges.
On Thursday, March 16th, chow down on Nachos Grande, flippingly good fish nuggets or poppity popcorn chicken. Your choice of a cornbread muffin or dinner roll comes with the sides of baked black beans, corn salad, a sweet potato, and diced pears.
Then on Friday, March 17th, stuff yourself silly with spaghetti with a breadstick, roasted chicken with a biscuit and gravy, or your deluxe chicken sandwich. The fun continues as you add macaroni salad, a baked potato, and tasty mixed fruit to your plate.
Finally, on Monday, March 20th, your tummy will yell yummy when it sees the delectable Chick-fil-A sandwich, a lasagna roll-up with a breadstick, or a flavorful corn dog nuggets on your plate. Top it all off with black-eyed peas and diced peaches.
And there you have lunch menu for the week. In addition to those items, milk, a garden salad, fresh fruit, French bread pizza, and a peanut butter and jelly combo will be available daily.
So many delicious choices. Don't forget you can also start your day off with a healthy and hearty breakfast at school.
This Tuesday, March 14th is an exciting day for many Americans and even people around the world.
That's right. It's the beginning of the NCAA's Division I men's basketball tournament.
To celebrate this year's March Madness, we have a special segment which takes a brief look at the history of the tournament.
Each year as the cold disperses and the flowers start to sprout, certain sounds start to follow them. The bouncing of basketballs, screeching of sneakers on the battleground players call a court, and with hundreds of devoted fans screaming uncontrollably. This can only mean one thing, that an ancient tradition known as March Madness is back, and it's turning the humble and the animated fanatics. So where did this basketball madness originate from, and why does it have such a hold on millions every year? In a faraway land known as Illinois, it is believed that the Illinois High School Association is the founder of the first March Madness tournaments, starting on March 17, 1939. A small invitational tournament between surrounding colleges that would sell out crowds at the University of Illinois long before it was dubbed March Madness. March Madness would not get its name until Henry Porter, assistant executive of the Illinois High School Association, wrote an essay dedicated to honor it. It appeared in the Illinois Interscholastic in 1939. The name stuck with newspapermen and readers, and during the 1940s and the 1950s, the name grew in popularity along with the tournament. Over the years, more than 900 schools have been competing to join the Sweet 16, a coalition of the last 16 teams to play for the title, and the winner of the tournament was crowned NCAA champion. Since its debut in 1939, March Madness has gotten much bigger than just Illinois, with the entire United States going crazy with basketball fever. The games start on March 14th every year and end on April 3rd, with more than 29 million people watching every year and drawing in $900 million in revenue, most of which comes from broadcasting rights. The NCAA signed a 14-year contract in 2006 with Turner Broadcasting and CBS Sports for $10.8 billion, giving the broadcasting rights to the games. 68 teams now participate in the tournament, which, with their own divisions and rivalries. In 2013, over 75% of the country said they have heard of the tournament, and 60% said they have watched a game at some point. This madness has become an American pastime. Over the years and decades, many teams have made their mark during the tournament. There have been undefeated runs, spectacular finales, and heartbreaking losses. Each generation of Americans have their own classic March Madness memories. So this March, why not see what all the madness is about and watch new stories being born as teams from across the country compete for the all-elusive title of NCAA champion.
Thanks, Tyler, for all that great March Madness information. I'm excited about the tournament. Jimmy, are there any teams you're pulling for?
I'm pulling for the Carolina Tar Heels. What about you, Sierra?
I'm not a big basketball fan, but NC State would definitely be my top pick.
Well, with March Madness beginning this week, we will see what happens.
Yes, we will.
All right, everyone, get a pen and paper ready. It's time for our morning show math question. This is a challenging problem for you to solve at home. We'll give you the question now and then solve it for you after a break. So put on your thinking caps and get ready to solve our morning math question, because here it is. Okay, we hope you got that down. Spend a minute working it out, and we will have the answer after the short break.
Stay tuned, we'll be right back.
Introducing the all-new Enclave. It's a minivan to the max, with features like remote control sliding rear doors, 150 cable channels, a full sky view roof, temperature controlled cup holders, and the 6-point navigation system. It's the minivan for families on the go.
What state am I?
I'm the southernmost of the New England states. My capital is known as the insurance capital of the world. I'm home to the oldest continuously published paper in the U.S. Do you know who I am? If you guessed Connecticut, you're right. I received statehood in 1788.
This United States factoid has been brought to you by New Hanover County Schools on the Learning Network of the Cape Fear.
Nice, Dad. Nice, Dad. Nice, Dad.
Charles!
Nice, Dad.
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. There are thousands of siblings in foster care who'll take you just as you are.
Welcome back to The Morning Show. I'm Sierra Demermuth.
And I'm Jimmy Barnes.
Before the break, we showed you our Morning Show math question.
Were you able to solve it correctly? Here is Elizabeth Crace, math teacher at Murray Middle School, with the solution.
Here we have our math problem of the day. Mrs. Page took her students to a museum. Each student bought $1.80 to cover the cost of admission. If she collected $34.20, how many students paid their admission price? This was the total amount collected. This is what our admission cost is. So I'm going to need to divide to find out the total number of students that paid their admission. So I'm going to put my $34.20 inside my division sign because I want to know how many $1.80s go into $34.20. So I have $1.80 going into $34.20. Well, with division of decimals, you cannot have a decimal outside of the division sign. So I'm going to move my decimal point over two places. Whatever you do outside of a division sign, you also need to do inside. So I'm going to move it over here two places and bring up my decimal point. Some people might find it easier to rewrite your problem. So I'm going to do so and show that my decimal point is now at the end. So I have a new problem of 180 going into 3,420 with my decimal point at the end. I don't have to worry about my decimal point anymore for a little while. I have to make an educated guess now how many 180s fit into here. Well, I know they do not fit into 3. I do know that they do not fit into 4. I know that 180 does not fit into 34, but it does fit into 342. And I'm going to guess about one time. And one times 180 is 180. And so I'm going to do some subtraction here to find how much I have left over. And I have 162 left over. Well, 180 does not go into 162, so my estimation of 1 was correct. I'm now going to bring down the 0. And now I want to know how many 180s fit into 1,620. So I'm going to make an educated guess. I'm going to guess that 180 can go into 1,620. I'm going to say about 8 times. So I'm going to check that out before I do my math here on my problem. 8 times 0 is 0. 8 times 8 is 64. I'm going to carry my 6. 8 times 1 is 8 plus 6 gives me 1,440. I'm pretty close to 1,620. So I'm going to guess I can get one more 180 in there. So I'm going to see if I can add in another 180 and if I can get there. Bring that one up. And I'm at 1,620. I'm at 1,620. So I had these 8 plus this 1. So I have 19. So 19 students attended the museum. And I can check that by saying 19 times 180 should give me my 3,420. And I have no money left over. And now back to the studio.
We hope you enjoyed our morning show math problem and we got those brain juices flowing.
Each week we'll feature a new problem for you to solve.
We now have our March segment of Snapshots.
In Snapshots, we take a quick look at some of the positive things going on around our school system.
From fun projects to school-wide events to guest speakers and fabulous field trips, there's so many great things for our schools to celebrate.
Congratulations to Myrtle Grove Middle School for winning the Black History Quiz Bowl. Championship for the second consecutive year. This event is designed to broaden students' perspective on African American achievements in topics ranging from science, politics, entertainment, and more.
College Park Elementary received a generous grant from the Wilmington Downtown Rotary Club. Students were so excited to select from the new books funded by the grant, adding to the library's collection.
Laney High School dancers visited Ogden Elementary during Arts Education Week and demonstrated some of their dances. Students from both schools had excellent time learning and interacting with each other.
Second grade students at Eaton Elementary completed biographies about famous people. The students then presented their biographies with a costume cutout.
Mr. Thomas's English class at Ashley High School engaged students in book speed dating, an active and exciting way to explore a variety of books and games and genres.
Hoggard High School's National Arts Honor Society and Art Club collaborated to create their annual card fundraiser using the skills and processes learned in the classroom. The two groups wanted to give back to the community by donating this year's funds to the Lower Cape Fear Hospice.
That was this month's Snapshots. A look at just a few of the many positive things happening in our school system.
It's time for more Your School News. Let's send it back over to news anchor Bridget Donovan.
Thank you, Sierra and Jimmy, and welcome everyone to your school news here on The Morning Show. New Hanover County Schools hosted a magnet and year-round options fair. Staffs from each school were available to greet parents, answer questions, and provide detailed information about the programs and how to register their student. With a complete report is YSN reporter Natasha Griffin.
Parents looking for a unique school experience for their elementary or middle school students have a chance to get information on a variety of programs at school systems' recent magnet and choice school fairs. Staffs from each school and other central office staff were on hand to greet parents, answer questions, and provide detailed information about the programs at all magnet and choice schools. Parents learned about special programs, gifted programs, benefits, and the lottery process.
March 20th to April 28th is registration for everyone else. So if you are interested and you didn't make it to the fair, then you have a window. The information will be online as of March 1st. So just go to the magnet website and you'll get some more information there.
Parents had lots of questions about the new language immersion program at the International School at Gregory. And staff was on hand to talk with them. DC Virgo featured an incredible display of STEM-related activities that are part of the school's everyday curriculum.
One thing about Gregory that makes us different is that our students, when they enroll, they have half of their day or half of their instruction in Spanish and half in English. So it's not a class. It's more or less the daily life of the student where their instruction is held at the same level as every other student in the county, but the delivery is just in Spanish.
At DC Virgo, we have a STEAM focus. And so what makes it unique is that the whole learning experience for a child is an extended opportunity. So what that child learns goes far beyond what's happening in that classroom environment. So it's taking the lesson, it's taking that math formula and making it more meaningful for that child.
Schools featured at this year's two fairs were Coddington, Freeman, Gregory, Snipes, Eaton, and Virgo Preparatory Academy. For parents who could not make it to the fairs but are still interested in one of the magnet or choice schools, can contact the schools directly for information. All school information can be found on the school system's website. Reporting for your school news, this is Bridget Donovan.
The Wilmington in Color Coloring Book Tour made a stop at the International School at Gregory. This amazing book features crucial Black history historical sites like Bellamy Mansion and Thalian Hall, which were built by free and enslaved Blacks. A paragraph of information outlines the building's origin paired with illustrations ready to color. Other landmarks featured in the book included Williston Middle School, formerly Williston High School, the town's first school for Blacks, and what was left of the Wilmington Daily Record after a mob burned the building down in the race riot of 1898 are also featured in the book. The author of the books have been teaming up with local community members and organizations to read excerpts of the book to students across the city. Guest readers include County Commissioner Jonathan Barfield, Isla Speller, Evelyn Bryant, Annie Jacobs, and Travis Corpening. The goal of the coloring books is to depict the African-American history of Wilmington in a new media that is entertaining and educational. The author of the book, Cedric Harrison, pitched the idea of the coloring book to the students at New Hanover High School, and with the help of their teacher, Elizabeth Feltz, and the University of North Carolina Wilmington Professor Janet Robertson, the book Wilmington in Color was created. Students at Anderson Elementary School had the opportunity to have a ton of fun, but also help save lives. Each of the grades at Anderson Elementary had the chance to participate in Jump Rope for Heart. Physical education teacher Curtis Fallon at Anderson Elementary has held the event for many years in order to keep the future generations physically fit, but also knowledgeable about the dangers of heart disease and stroke.
This year, our goal is $16,000. Our highest was a little over 15,000 so far 2 years ago. We got about 14,000 last year, so we're gonna try to reach that 16,000 mark.
Jump Rope for Heart is an event by the American Heart Association that fights to free people from the horrible affliction of cardiovascular diseases and stroke. To achieve this goal, they enlist the help of those who volunteer. Every year, more than 300,000 students participate to raise awareness of heart diseases. As the students jump rope, bounce, skip, and twirl, they are building physical strength, establishing friendships, confidence in their own abilities, social skills, and understanding that they are helping those less fortunate. That's all for now. To watch this week's edition of Your School News online, visit the school system's website at www.nhcs.net and click on the NHCS TV logo at the home page. Now back over to Sierra and Jimmy.
Thanks, Bridget. Now coming up, we have a fantastic morning show game titled Spin the Pizza.
We're going to take a quick break while we set up for the game, so stay tuned. You don't want to miss it.
We'll be right back.
History's Timeline, a world of history in 60 seconds, brought to you by New Hanover County Schools. 336 BC, Alexander the Great becomes king of Macedonia and crushes a revolt by Athens, Thebes, and other Greek cities. 332 BC, Alexander invades and conquers Egypt and founds the city of Alexandria. 323 BC, Alexander dies of malaria and his empire is divided among his generals. 217 BC, Hannibal annihilates a Roman army at Lake Trasimene. 214 BC, construction of the Great Wall of China begins. This has been History's Timeline, an educational snapshot of the fascinating people, places, and events that have shaped our history.
Welcome back to the morning show. I'm Bridget Donovan, and I'm here with Sierra Demmermuth and Jimmy Barnes. We close our show with an exciting game we call Spin the Pizza. Sierra and Jimmy will compete to be the first to score 5 points and win the title Pizza Champ, which includes bragging rights for an entire year. The game is simple. Our contestants take turns spinning the pizza wheel and answer a question from the category they land on. Our categories are pizza question, multiple choice, true false, and random question. They may also land on free point or lose a turn. Okay, Sierra, we'll get to spin the pizza wheel first.
Sweet. It's hard to spin, but.
Free point.
All right, sweet.
Starting off good.
Okay, so Jimmy. I don't think it works like that.
See, that's what I need to do next time.
Oh. Free point, okay.
All right.
True or
50
false?
50-50 chance.
Okay. So, true or false, the U.S. eats more pizza than the rest of the world combined?
True.
Correct. Yes. So that's a point.
I mean, I eat pizza more than everyone else combined, so.
Lose a turn.
Oh,
shucks.
Oh, well.
Random question, okay. What is a pregnant goldfish called? That is not the right answer. Okay.
I didn't even
Goldie,
get the answer.
Twit, glop, or koi pod?
Wait, what were the choices?
Okay. Goldie, twit, glop, or koi pod?
I'm gonna go with Goldie.
That's wrong. Oh. It's twit.
Twit, really? Feel
yeah.
Like a twit.
I think that's a book name, actually.
Maybe it is.
Okay. Yes.
Okay, free points.
Gonna win off of free points. Fingers crossed.
We'll see.
Mm. Free point again.
Hey. Okay, I think this wheel's rigged.
Check the bottom of
three.
It.
3-1. Okay, multiple choice. Okay. What percentage of people consider pizza the perfect breakfast? 15%, 36%, 46%, or 55%?
A.
15%?
Yes.
No, it's 36.
Oh, wow.
Barbarians.
This is bad luck. Running.
This wheel is rigged.
Was that multiple choice?
Yeah,
yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Multiple choice.
The average pizzeria uses how many pizza boxes each day?
Oh, Jesus.
20, 33, 47, or 55?
55.
That's correct.
Okay. I was expecting it to be like in the thousands or something crazy, if I'm being honest.
You would think it'd be more.
Yeah.
True or false? Okay. The average slice of pizza has 350 calories. True or false?
Orange pizza.
Oh, I know this one.
True.
It's false. It has 285 calories.
Okay.
That's a lot.
Yeah, it's worth it. What does that mean?
Point.
I win? Told you I was gonna win off of 3 points.
Is that five?
Okay. Yeah,
that's fine. All right, so our winner and pizza champ for the year is Sierra Dummermuth, right?
Woo.
Congratulations.
Good game, Jimmy.
Good game.
Well, that does it for this edition of The Morning Show.
Remember, for the best TV all of all, each and every day, keep it turned right here to NHCS, New Hanover County Schools TV on the Learning Network.
Have a great day.
And a wonderful week.